Welcome. On this very cold evening, welcome to the Writer's House and welcome to the Writers Without Borders series. We're really grateful to several people for this series. First of all, to Seth Ginns, who's a Penn alumnus, for his ongoing support of this series, and to Penn's Provost, who basically challenged the Writer's House to do an international author series. And we're grateful for that challenge because it has allowed us to really think broadly and expansively about a world of literature and not just the Eastern Seaboard, which is easy for us. So that has been great. And tonight's event, you should know, is also co-sponsored by Penn's Middle East Center and by Al Bustan Seeds of Culture. Everyone we've spoke to about this event has been excited and thrilled and saying, I can't believe this is really happening. So that has been wonderful. And tonight, I should say, is a special treat, partly because of Roger Allen. When this series was just getting off the ground, Professor Allen was among the first people I contacted to find out, you know, who should we bring? What should we do? And for those of you who don't know him, he's a professor of Arabic and comparative literature in the Department of Near Eastern Languages here at Penn. And he's known internationally as a translator and as a scholar of Arabic literature. Above all, and this is from his website, it's such a great quote, I had to basically take it verbatim. Above all, Roger's hope is to maintain and increase the kinds of academic, scholarly, and personal contact between Western specialists and Arab writers and critics. He sees this as the most important development in his career. So we're lucky to have Roger here at Penn, and we're lucky to have Roger involved in the Writer's House. When I asked him, you know, what should we do? What should we do? He, without hesitation, right away, without any thought, was just the thing that jumped right to his head. He said, well, we should invite Hanan. I'm going to get this. I'm going to try to do this. Al-Shaykh?
Yes.
Hanan al-Shaykh. And he's been instrumental in arranging her visit, in setting up class meetings, in arranging meetings with students over lunch. We do have a lunch program tomorrow that's absolutely full. We have a waiting list. And Roger and Hanan have been recently working together, translating Hanan's work. So having them here together is a great kind of synergy for us. And we do have a reception planned, a very small reception for after. So if you're interested in talking about translation or what that's like, or hearing about Arabic literature or what's happening in the world of literature generally, I think this is a perfect pair for that. So I want to close by saying I'm really grateful to Penn partners like Roger, who make readings like this possible. They help us get in touch with authors that we admire, that we admire from afar, that we think we're not going to be able to pull that one off. And then it happens very easily. From our perspective, I know travel can be hard and visas confusing. It's so easy for me, which is great. And of course, for helping to bridge the cultural divides that have been so important to Roger Allen's career. So please do help me welcome Roger Allen.
Thank you, Jessica, and good evening to you all. It's absolutely wonderful to see such a wonderful mixture here of people who I know as specialized in the Middle East. We have some speakers of Arabic here. We have people who don't know any Arabic. We have people who are aspiring to learn Arabic and indeed aspiring to learn about Arabic literature. But we also have some specialists in other world literary traditions. So we have a wonderful mixture. And that is absolutely perfect, I think, for introducing to you one of the Arab world's most important writers in general, but women writers in particular. And I'm going to zero in on the second part of that because in my experience teaching Arabic literature and also trying to introduce the treasures of world literature and Arabic literature in a comparative framework, the topic of women's writing and women's writing across different world cultures is fascinating and sometimes problematic. In many instances, the kinds of writings that people in this country tend to read tend to be the writings written by Middle Eastern women, specifically aimed at people in the Western world who want to read women's literature, rather than actually reflecting the creativity of women in the various world cultures, and I'm thinking specifically about the Middle East. What I tend to call the book club kind of women's literature. But quite beyond that, I want to tell you about Hanan al-Shaykh, because she is somebody who basically from the very outset has set entirely different parameters for writing as a Middle Eastern person, as a Lebanese person, as somebody who comes from the Shia community of southern Lebanon, which makes everything that she writes of particular interest. But she has always insisted on the start about talking with complete openness and complete frankness about the situation in her country and in the Middle East, and about the status of women in the Middle East, without trying to force any particular agenda or to reflect any particular biases, whether in her own culture or in Western culture. And that gives her writings an extreme importance and a great relevance both in the history of the development of modern Arabic fiction, and I'll say post-Second World War Arabic fiction, post-1967 Arabic fiction even more so. She is the author of a number of extremely important novels which have a key place in any history of the modern Arabic novel, whether written by men or women, or whether coming from one region of the Arab world or another. And it is for that reason, of course, that almost all her works have been translated into many languages, English among them. I will just simply mention, because I still continue to use this novel, Hikayat Zahra, the story of Zahra, which, while it may focus on the events of the Lebanese Civil War between 1975 and 1988, is of a technical brilliance and an interest for a whole series of reasons as to make it of continuing importance. Miskal Ghazal, a wonderful representation, I think, of her impressions of a time spent in Saudi Arabia, which is available in English as Women of Sand and Myrrh. And then a novel which actually I notice is on the table outside only in London, which is perhaps slightly different, and it is the impression of somebody of Lebanese and Arab descent writing about exile and being in London, but talking about Arabs who live in London. Most recently, she and I have been involved in translating a very, very fascinating narrative. And I'll leave it to her to describe whether it's a novel or it's a biography or it's an autobiography. I am quite happy to say it's probably all of those, because across the spectrum of fiction these days, it's not quite clear how we differentiate those from each other. This is Hikayati Sharhun Yatul, which basically, as I found out very soon after agreeing to translate it, is almost untranslatable into anything which makes much sense in English. It makes a good deal of sense. It's a very well-known phrase in Arabic, but in English it doesn't come out sounding quite right. It is about to be published by Bloomsbury, which is Harry Potter land, for those of you who don't know Bloomsbury. But that is an enormous coup and is extremely important. It will come out in London in the new year, called The Locust and the Bird. It's the story of her mother's life, told in her mother's voice by Hanan, and Hanan emerges at some point in the narrative when her mother happens to give birth to the personage in the novel who happens to turn out to be Hanan. So it is a wonderful story. It's full of details about the community in which her mother grows up and about which Hanan knows a great deal. It's also about Beirut and the complexities of life in that city. It is a wonderfully rich narrative, and I know that she's going to read to you extracts from that. So we have here tonight an immensely important figure in modern Arabic fiction, and therefore I'm delighted to introduce her to you, Hanan.
Thank you. Thank you, Roger. So nice to be here. I'm going to read from the book which Roger was talking about, Hikayati Sharhun Yatul. I'm going to read first in Arabic to give you some flavor. Hikayati Sharhun Yatul. ها هي حكايتي كتبتها لي ابنتي حنان. حتى إذا رويتها لها توقفت عن لوم نفسي. كنا نجلس معا من غير آلة تسجيل تخط في دفاترها الصغيرة التي تشبه المفكرات التي ألصقت عليها الصور، ومنها صورتي وأنا أتسلم كأسا فضية عندما توجت إحدى بناتي ملكة الرقص لأهرع إلى أحدهم في لجنة الحكم طالبة إليه أن يتظاهر بتقديم الكأس لي، ومنها أيضا صورة امرأة عارية الصدر وصورة نساء فوق دراجة ملتفات بالعباءات السوداء يقودها شاب. كنت أستهل حديثنا قائلة: حكايتي شرح يطول لوم الجرادة ما علي عصفور. ولم تسألني حنان قط ما معنى هذه الكلمة، إذ أيقنت أن عصفورا لحق بجرادة، لذلك وقع في الفخ. ما أن أصابني المرض حتى توقفت حنان عن كتابة حكايتي، خبأت كل الأوراق التي في الكيس وأخفته في مكان ما في إحدى خزائنها، ثم تعود إلى أوراقي وتكمل حكايتي بعد مرور عامين من وفاتي. حكاية بكايا شرح يطول لو ما جرادة ما علق عصفور، عن ملك كان يتمشى في البساتين عندما دخلت جرادة بكم ثوبه الفضفاض، وإذا بعصفور يلحق بها داخل الكم. يخيط الملك الفتحة ويجلس على العرش سائلا رعيته: ماذا في كمي؟ ولم يعرف أحد ما في كم الملك، إلى أن وقف بين يدي الملك رجل يدعى عصفور، كان قد تلوع من حب امرأة اسمها جرادة، ولم يكن على باله إلا صورة حبيبته، فاستهل حديثه قائلا: حكايا بكايا شرح يطول لو ما جرادة ما على عصفور. I'm going to time myself. What I'm going to read happened in the mid-30s. Now my mother is talking, and the title of this chapter, You Are Hereby My Witness. I was up on the roof one day when Mother and Khadija called to me to come. They told me I must go into the boys' bedroom and say the words, You are hereby my witness. Then I could go back to playing. Khadija gave me a white headscarf to wear. I went into the room and found myself facing a group of men in red fezes and another man in a turban shaped like a melon, just like the one worn by the sheikh whom Mother went to see about her alimony in Nabatiye. I tried to say, You are hereby my witness, so I could run out of the room, but I was nailed to the spot, unable to speak. The man in the turban stared at the floor and mouthed sentences. What I could understand sounded like prayers. In the name of God, and may God pray for and bless the Prophet Muhammad and his family. When he said this, the man repeated it after him. Suddenly, the man in the turban asked my age, and Ibrahim answered, She is 11 years old. Then the man recited something again, and I heard my name and Abu Hussein's. Then he asked me to repeat after him, You are hereby my witness. I mumbled the words and rushed to the door, opened it, and found Mother and Khadija standing right there as though they had been listening. I was afraid they would change their minds and stop me going back up to the roof to play. So I said, okay, it's done. I said, you are hereby my witness. What more do you want? Then I ran back up to the roof. I was surprised that the grown-ups had been wasting their time listening to me repeat what the man in the turban told me to say. I was equally surprised that they were letting me play rather than making me sweep the floor, clean up the dishes, or telling me off. I forgot all about what had happened that day and the words I uttered until nearly 2 years later when I met a young man who looked like a film star at the home of Fatme, the seamstress. Abu Hussein had sent me to Fatme's to learn to cut and sew because I'd been pestering them about school again. I was too old, they told me. The younger children at school would laugh at me. Let them laugh, I said. But mother replied that school lasted all day. Who would take the boys to school? Who would deliver my brother-in-law his lunch? Who would help with the washing? So instead, I was taken to Fatma's house. She welcomed me with a big smile, and as soon as my brother-in-law left, I could feel her opening her heart to me. I adored her. She was different from any woman I'd ever met. She talked loudly with a Beirut accent, cursing, swearing, and laughing. Her laughter went on and on, just like the cry of the hyenas. There was always a cigarette dangling from her lips, and she would blow smoke in my face when she exhaled it through her long nose. She had big eyes that could be gentle and furious at the same time. She never cried. She turned up the volume on the radio and drank coffee all day, one cup after another. Her teeth were as brown as dates, and she smoked and swayed to the music while she bent over the sewing machine or sat on the ground in the courtyard with fabric spread out over her heavy thighs. Once she sent me out for a pack of cigarettes, and I was amazed at the way she pulled notes casually from her pockets. I told her that she was the only person I knew who did that. My brother and brother-in-law were so stingy that if they could, they would have hidden their cash inside the crop of a chicken. She laughed and told me to take off my headscarf, then grabbed my thick black hair with the cigarette still dangling from her mouth. She told me how beautiful I was. At the time, I didn't realize that the kindness and affection she showed me was because of her sympathy towards my plight. When I arrived late in the morning, I would tell her what I'd been doing. I understand, she'd say. I understand. You are like the stone-bearing donkey. I wanted to live with her. She told everyone who visited about my nice house and my brother-in-law who owned a shop in Sousse. She made me feel proud, but I still giggled as I acted out how Abu Hussein walked with his head down in case he stumbled over something in his path. I told her how he poked his nose into everything like an old fussing hen. I loved to watch Fatma's hands work their magic with the sewing machine. She taught me how to pleat together, and I put on buttons. But the moment she left me to go into the kitchen and start cooking, I would sneak into her room, spread out her mother's prayer mat, and slide underneath the brass bed, which stood high up off the floor. There I'd sleep contentedly until she came in and scolded me. Come along, you get up. You are too spoiled. I was eager to get to Fatma's place every day, needle in hand. I would sit there alone, far removed from the bustle of our house, from all the shouting and the demands for me to do this and not to do that. Like the harvesters and farmers had in Nabatiye, I sang to myself as I worked, but not in the way I sang when I bathed at home. Then I had to sing quietly so that Ibrahim or my brother-in-law would not hear me. As I sang, I imagined myself as a heroine who embroidered while waiting for her beloved. He had been sent far away because he was rich and she was poor. For love of you, I have sacrificed my longing. Had I obeyed my heart, I would never have left you. I would sing, then I would begin another song, because I couldn't remember all the words of the first one. O thou rose of pure love, God bless the hands that have nourished you. I wonder, oh, I wonder, oh, I wonder. One day, a young relative of Fatmi overheard me singing. He sat by the fountain in the garden, pretending to read, and waited until I appeared. I looked out the window and saw a young man sitting by the edge of the fountain, as though a genie had conjured him out of the water and put him there. It looked like a scene from The White Rose, though this young man was not wearing a fez. I listened as he asked Fatmi in a gentle whisper, "So where did this beautiful girl come from?" "From Nabatiye," Fatmi replied. "He didn't look like any other man I'd ever seen, either in Nabatiye or Beirut. Most of them had black curly hair and black eyes that were close together. They were either short, or if they were tall, then fat. The young man before me had straight brownish hair and eyes of a color I could not name. And he was tall. He too had come from a village in the south, close to the sea, in order to go to school in Sidon. Fatmi told me proudly that his family were what she called high life. When it was obvious I had no idea what she meant, she added, "Not the way it was down here. His family were notables and emirs. His father had been village mayor for the past 30 years. They owned 2 race horses." I told her that my grandfather had owned a horse. "Your grandfather owned a mule," she replied with a smile. "A horse is completely different." The phrase high life stuck in my mind. I was surrounded by people from the south who were struggling to make a living, while this young man's family, his name was Muhammad, made their horses race and earned money from them. I realized exactly what Raouf's gambling husband had been up to, pawning everything they owned so he could be on the horses. I wondered whether the money had gone to Muhammad's family, and though I wanted to ask Fatmi, I decided it was probably better not to. Instead, I listened as she proudly and happily told me how the young man slept at her house once a month when he came from Sidon to Beirut. From then on, I waited for Muhammad to appear again in the garden with his book. When he appeared, I would watch as he gazed into the fountain and then at the house. When eventually we did exchange a few words, the first thing I asked him was if he had seen the white rose. I stared straight at his jacket and asked if he owned another. He hesitated a moment. "Of course I do," he replied. "Why do you ask?" I told him that I wanted to give Abdul Wahab a jacket, because in the film he sang, "No jacket, it makes me weep," with such passion. Muhammad burst out laughing and began to sing the words as they really are. "Ya mashakit wa bakit." How long I wept and moaned. I witnessed joy and bliss and drank from the cup of desire. He asked me how old I was, and I told him I was 13. He told me he was 17. He asked why I was learning to sew. Did I really like embroidering and cutting so much? "It's better than doing nothing," I replied. "If you'd gone to school," he said, "you'd know what Abdul Wahab was singing." I tried to hide my embarrassment. "He was singing in Egyptian," I hurriedly replied. "That's why I didn't understand." "And how were you going to get the jacket to him?" he asked with a laugh. "Abdul Wahab must own hundreds of jackets," he told me. I shouldn't really believe the things I saw on screen, even though such films were supposed to hold a mirror up to our society. The White Rose was the first Arabic film to contain singing, but the most striking thing about it, he told me, was that it showed how the rich never married the poor or even middle-class people. The film's message was that this meant the love always suffered. He went on to tell me how Abdul Wahab brother had beaten him because he loved singing and music so much. I told him in turn how my brother Hassan wanted to play the lute professionally, but instead had to work in a bakery. I told him how, just like Abdul Wahab, he was scared to play the lute in front of his younger brother Ibrahim, who didn't approve of music. I also told him about Kamel and his lovely voice, that he wanted to become a singer, but didn't know how to go about it. I started looking forward to seeing Muhammad, especially after he said, "God preserve that lovely dimple of yours." He set me right on many things. When I told him how unfriendly my brother Ibrahim was to me, he said, "My brother was cross with mother because she'd married father and taken him out of school. His anger at her was channeled to me." Muhammad began to offer me advice of all kinds. He did it with the utmost delicacy, as if tiptoeing on eggshells. Once he noticed how I kept my money in a pouch hung around my neck under my clothes, he suggested I get myself a small handbag. As the weeks went by, he grew bolder and suggested I needed to wear a brassiere. And in fact, I already noticed the way passers-by stared at my chest when I ran. When he saw me rubbing my teeth with salt and water, he gave me a toothbrush and toothpaste. I watched as he did his homework, dipping his quill pen into the inkwell. I told him that the inkwell was just like a dark well and that the words looked like nails on the page. He nodded his head in amazement and asked where I had heard the description. I told him I made it up and asked him to read what he'd written aloud. He read aloud as if he was on the radio, or was Abdul Wahab himself. I imagine he was the author of everything that he wrote until he admitted that he copied things he liked from magazines. "O life of the soul, O soul of life, my heart is yours. Is yours mine also? Tell me, I beg you, O my life." I recited the song I thought up when I still lived in the South. "Do not rejoice, O long-haired wheat, tomorrow come the sykes to do a merry dance and tickle your stomach, to cut off those long tresses. The songs of the fields will fade when the locks are all gone." Then Muhammad stopped coming to visit Fatme. I decided that his family must have had something to do with it. Although Fatme insisted, he was just busy studying for his exam. Now I understood the true meaning of the word longing. It was the feeling I had when I passed the fountain and he wasn't there, or when I saw his pen and inkwell on the bureau. I was bereft. 3 whole weeks passed before he appeared at the fountain again. Overcome with joy, I ran to him. He greeted me coldly. Was it, I wondered, because my brassiere had snapped and I wasn't wearing one? He ignored me and kept on reading the book in his hand. "Is it a historical tale?" I asked. "No," he replied curtly. "It's poetry." "What is it called?" "The Swinging of the Moon." "So even the moon has a swing," I said with a laugh. He didn't laugh back, and his severe expression reminded me of Ibrahim. I turned to leave utterly perplexed. "So you're engaged," he said. I turned back to him and he glared at me accusingly. "And you kept it from me." The only thing I could think of was the vendor who had tried to get a kiss from me in turn to some extra lard. Could I have become engaged to him without realizing it? "Come on, Camilla," Muhammad said, raising his voice. "Let's cut out all the deceit and hypocrisy. You are engaged to your dead sister's husband, and you've been hiding it from me." "Me engaged to that old man? By God's own life, by the Prophet and Imam Ali, I am not engaged to anyone." "Congratulations," he said. I began to cry. Here we were, the hero and heroine together standing by the fountain. The hero was hurling accusation at the heroine with her pale complexion and thick black hair. She fluttered around him in tears, protesting her innocence and trying to defend herself. I felt like throwing myself at his chest and weeping. No, no, you must believe me. You have to believe me. Muhammad called across the courtyard to Fatma's uncle, who was busy preparing a prime stove. He walked over. That family of yours are a load of criminals, by God. The same goes for the Sheikh who drew up your engagement contract. I've heard the whole story from one of the witnesses. He didn't want to witness the engagement of an 11-year-old girl, but eventually he gave in. I remember the turbaned Sheikh sitting in my nephew's room 2 years earlier. It suddenly struck me what those fatal words, "You are hereby my witness," he meant. And it explained what the turbaned Sheikh and all those men were doing in our house. By this time, Fatmi was standing next to me, swaying from side to side, clucking in sympathy. I ran home to ask mother whether it was true. The engagement, mother lied to me, was nothing more than a mock marriage for religious purposes. We did it so that God would not punish you if your brother-in-law saw you without a scarf. I ran straight back to Fatma's. Too late, Fatma told me. Muhammad had already left for his school in Sidon, swearing he'd never return to Beirut. My heart sank, but Fatma hugged me and told me that Muhammad was deeply in love with me. She said he had simply melted in the face of my beauty and sense of fun. In fact, he had been in love with me ever since I asked him for his jacket to send to Abdul Wahab. Her words made me sob. Was it possible that I was loved? I wept, even more because Muhammad had gone away and might never come back to hear what I had to tell him. He didn't stick to his resolution, though, and the day came when I found him waiting for me by the fountain again. The sight of him standing in the sunlight, watching the dragonflies playing on the water, made me realize how much I loved him. But I felt shy and afraid he would reject me. Okay, I told him. I did say the words, "You are hereby my witness." But it was a mock marriage. So if Abu Hussein saw my hair, I wouldn't enter hell. That's it, and not for tir. Muhammad looked at me strangely and asked me what that last word was. I repeated it for him. Tir, when he asked what I meant by it, I hid my face, embarrassed, mortified, and unable to answer. I had no idea where the word had come from, nor if it was a real word, or I'd invented it to describe what happened between men and women. Was there marriage, kisses, having babies? A single drop of blood. Muhammad became as important to me as eating bread. When he gave me a bunch of violet, my mind went a flutter and my heart pounded. Was the bunch of violet really for me? I would ask, and he would reply that it was. I began to pirouette like a butterfly. Then the day arrived when a single drop of blood on my underwear sent me crying in a panic to Fatma, convinced I was about to die. I would seem that when I spotted blood on my underwear and assumed it meant I was going to die. I was not too far off. It was as if that single drop of blood was an alarm bell, one that could cancel time by days, months, and years. My family tricked me into letting someone to take my measurements by pretending I was the same size as Khadija's cousin, who couldn't be there for a fitting. But then I found, quite by chance, a white wedding dress and realized I was about to be married. I burst into tears and began at my tearing my hair, holding my hands up to mother and Khadija to show them I really had pulled out a clump of it. "Don't do this to me," I screamed, beating my chest. "God have pity, God have pity." I ran to Fatma to tell her what was happening. She confessed that my brother-in-law had only let me learn how to sew so I could become a carbon copy of his former wife, Manifa. Even you, Fatma, I sobbed. Why didn't you warn me? Why didn't you scream at my brother-in-law and shame him? How on earth could I have believed that my family wanted me to learn to sew so I'd have been a profession? How could you do this to me? I asked mother through my tears. She cried too, and so did Khadija. But they had tricked me, and now they were trying to talk me into the marriage. The hearts of three children lay in my hands. I was told if I married their father, they would be able to bounce back and live normal lives. If I refused, then a cruel stepmother would let their hearts slowly fade and eventually cease beating. Everything about my nephews made people sad. If they laughed, people began to cry because their mother would never get to hear their laughter. Even the religious names were a source of grief. Hussein was named after the Prophet's grandson, who was martyred and beheaded. Hassan was poisoned. And Imam Ali, the Prophet's son-in-law, was murdered before his two sons. I went to see my music-loving, easygoing brother Hassan, who had by now married the woman he loved. In tears, I begged him to come to my rescue. Mother and Ibrahim were forcing me into marriage when I was only 13 years old. Aren't you the eldest brother? I asked. He's younger than you. He has to listen to you. Be patient, he replied, stroking my shoulder. I dried my eyes and blew my nose and waited for him to finish his sentence. But as soon as I calmed down a bit, he sighed his lute and asked if I'd like to hear him sing, "O Rose of Purest Love." Keep them on the run, was Fatma's suggestion. In other words, make a series of impossible requests in turn for agreeing to be married. That will win you more time, she said, especially since Abu Hussein, such a skinflint. Back in Nabatiya, I had heard fairy tales in which this type of bargaining was crucial. I remembered the story of clever Hassan. I want a peck of wheat from the stomach of a sparrow, but only if the bird was a blue feather in its wing, the right wing, never the left. I also remembered the tale of the tall black genie that appeared from the magic bottle and said, "Hey ho, greetings, I'm here to do your bidding." The hag said, "Put me on your back and fly me to a land where there are shoes that can talk, stamp, and clap." It always worked in stories, so I decided to try. My first demand was for roast chicken, but it had to be from a restaurant. Otherwise, I knew they'd bring me a chicken, keep it in the bathroom for several days, fatten it up a bit, and then slaughter it and cook it for the entire family. I was convinced that no one in our household who set foot in a restaurant. Such places were for rich, sophisticated people. To my great disappointment, the roast chicken duly arrived, purchased reluctantly by my brother-in-law. I pounced on it voraciously and began to swallow the flesh in chunks, sucking on the bones, even crunching on some of them, ignoring Ibrahim's disapproving glare. 2 days after getting the chicken, I let it be known that I still had no wish to marry my brother-in-law. Although we were living in the same apartment, I made myself scarce when I heard him, I'd disappear. When they asked me why I was so scared of him, in fact, he made my skin crawl. I shouted at them that I was too young to be married. When my aunt arrived from Nabatiye for a consultation about the snake in her stomach, she listened to my protests and then joined my family's campaign. She scolded me for being so selfish and not thinking about my sister's three children. My next demand was that mother and my aunt take me to the cinema. Mother let out a shriek and asked for God's forgiveness. "Good grief," she said. "I've lost two daughters in their prime, withering like basil leaves on the branch. And you expect me to go to the cinema?" I reassured her that the film I had in mind was a comedy without love scenes or singing. "So you want to make me laugh? Is that it? Why do you think I need to laugh?" My aunt, however, urged her to take me, so I'd agree to get married. Now tell me, mother asked, will you agree to marry your brother-in-law, or you're just playing games with us, you genie of the fields? I swore by the Prophet Imam Ali and the memory of my two dead sisters that this time I wouldn't change my mind. I went straight over to the mirror to fix my hair, feeling overjoyed that for the first time ever, I could go to the cinema without feeling guilty or afraid that Ibrahim might catch me. On our way there, we passed a striptease cabaret. My heart was in my mouth for fear mother would look up and her eyes fall on the scandalous pictures posted outside. To my relief, I saw she was lowering her headscarf over her eyes, which were weak in any case. But then the cabaret man at the door shouted, just a quarter, that's all. A quarter lira, dancing, jiggling breasts are swaying, all for a quarter. Mother heard every word. Get away, you son of a bitch, she screeched at him. I seized her by the hand and dragged her away. We went into the cinema and found our seats. I watched again as the rays of light and dust hit the screen, but the lights had only just gone down when people in the back seat started to shout, tell that tall one to move further back. Get her to sit in the back row. I realized my aunt was perched on the top of her seat. Just stand up a moment. I'll adjust your seat, I offered. But she shouted back, my God, bury the people alive who turned off the lights. We are in Beirut, aren't we? There is no need to economize. Tell them to put the light on so I can see what's in front of me. First, we watched a newsreel about the war in Europe. I'd learned the faces of the leaders from stickers that were sold everywhere in Beirut. An Italian with a square head, a German with a trimmed mustache who was extremely upset and annoyed, and a fat Englishman with an equally fat black cigarette in his hand. I thought he held a black cigarette because he was in mourning for the start of the war. There were scenes of tanks racing each other across the countryside. A tank approached the camera and its image filled the screen, bringing my aunt to her feet once more. Where on earth have you brought us? She yelled. I tugged my aunt's hand, trying to get her to sit down to the accompaniment of jeers and catcalls. The newsreel came to an end and the film began. It was Laurel and Hardy, who reminded me of Abu Hussein and Ibrahim. Laurel, the thin, short one with little to say, was my brother-in-law. Hardy, who was fat and big with a tiny mustache and a short temper, was gloomy Ibrahim. I was soon laughing so hard I had to keep slapping my cheeks. Mother fidgeted in her seat. In the name of heaven, she shouted, finally jumping up. Enough is enough. Tell them to calm down and stop making such a fuss. They keep running back and forth like a shuttle on a sewing machine. My eyes can't take it anymore. Oh, for pity's sake, why don't you just sit down? A man shouted at mother. With that, my aunt turned around. Pipe down, you good for nothing, she yelled. How dare you talk to us without even being introduced? Proud of myself and my tactics, I went to Fatma's house to tell her how I was delaying the wedding with my demands. What makes you think you are such a hot shot? She said, asking for roast chicken and a trip to the cinema. It's a gold watch and gold bracelets you should be asking for. So I went home straight away and asked for the things Fatma has suggested. That night I slept well. I was confident that sort of money would never leave my brother-in-law's pocket. He scolded us if the tap was left dripping when the soap was as thin as a piece of peel. He attached it to the fresh bar. And once, when the cat stole the meat he'd brought home, he'd stood there aghast, holding the empty wrapping, turning it over in disbelief, and then began to weep. I quickly put the remaining piece of fat on a plate next to his prayer mat as he prayed, hoping that perhaps God could hear him and change that piece of fat back into a piece of meat. But this time, the only miracle was that my brother-in-law did not refuse my requests. Instead, he bought me everything I asked for. When I saw the gold in Mother's and Khadija's hand, I fainted. The next thing I heard was, bring some rose water, quickly, bring some rose water. The scent must have loosened my tongue because I began begging the two of them. His old, I kept repeating, while still only half conscious. He's an adult and I'm still young, only a child. I echoed all that I'd heard Fatima, her uncle, and Muhammad say. At Fatima's house early the next morning, I found Muhammad waiting for me by the garden gate. Before I could say a word, he asked me to get my family to delay things for 6 months. But then, he would have graduated from his training to become a member of the government and found a job with the Securité Générale, the government interior ministry. As we walked into the garden, again I felt as if we were in a film. Muhammad placed his hand over his heart and grasped me by the shoulders. Don't give in, no matter how much they pressure you, he said. Just six months and we will be engaged. Don't be afraid. He took a small photograph of himself out of his coat and handed it to me. I put it in my brazier with a sigh. Promise me you won't get married. Whatever happens, I promise, I repeated after him. I won't get married. I decided I'd promise the family to get married in 6 months' time when I was 14. I would use the extra time to persuade Mother to stand by me and then put pressure on Ibrahim to release me from the engagement. But that night, when I heard Abu Hussein's footsteps on the stairs and Ibrahim shouting at one of his daughters, I changed my mind. I decided to escape to the south and ask Father to save me and let me stay with him for 6 months. Thank you.
Signing books.
It's a book signing, and let's have one more round of applause.